For those who see no clear distinction between the arts and the sciences, the software arts will be an old saw with some new. So, as I said, it will be published this fall by MIT Press. If you want to have a look before then, I've got the at least the penultimate draft up on our website. My talk has three parts. In the first, I provide a short overview of the emerging field of software studies. That's the series that MIT Press will be published. In the second, I give a chapter by chapter description of the book manuscript. And in the third, I'll read some passages from one of the chapters of the book. So if you follow job ads, you will see various media studies positions that refer to software studies. What is this software studies? The answer to this question today is comparable to the antecedent question that was current when I was on the job market about 20 years ago. And then the question is, what is new media? And now we answer this question by pointing to a set of venues like this one, and a set of publications like Lev Manovich's 2001 book, The Language of New Media. It is becoming possible to answer the question for software studies in an analogous manner. About 10 years ago, a group of us under the editorial powers of Matthew Fuller at Goldsmiths College put together a volume called Software Studies, a Lexicon. And now we have also, edited by Matthew, Computational Culture, a journal of software studies, actually the only journal of software studies. And there is this book series at MIT Press called Software Studies, for which Matthew Fuller, Lev Manovich, and Noah Warburg-Fruin, my colleague at UC Santa Cruz, serve as founding academic editors. So Warburg-Fruin's Expressive Processing, Digital Fictions, Computer Games, and Software Studies was the inaugural book in the series when it was published in 2009. Since then, there's been seven others in the series. The latest was Annette Pee's Coding Literacy, How Computer Programming is Changing Writing, that came out last year. And the one prior to that was Benjamin Bratton's The Stack on Software and Solidity. But it's increasingly obvious that works of software studies are being published outside of just MIT Press series and this journal. Even at MIT Press itself, not all the software studies books are being published in the software studies series. So just last year, for example, they published Paul Dorsch's The Stuff of Bits and Adrian McKenzie's Machine Learners. Other presses are also becoming places to look for works in software studies, like Matthew Fuller's How to Be a Geek, published by Polity Press, and Federica Crevetti's Software Theory, a Cultural and Philosophical Study, published by Roman and Littlefield. So there's a set of other adjacent endeavors that occasionally connect with software studies. These include platform studies, infrastructure studies, critical code studies, and critical algorithm studies. And in my talk today, I will try to make it clear how software studies is distinct from these other areas of study. So the areas just named are only the newest of a larger neighborhood. One would think, for instance, that computer historians would have written a lot about software, but much of computer history is focused on hardware, and only recently is it turning its attention to software. One might equally imagine that philosophers and historians of logic and mathematics would have written a lot about software. However, although they frequently touch on theoretical machines that are tantamount to software, rarely do they investigate contemporary works of software. Science and technology studies has, on a few occasions, taken an interest in software. Harry Collins' 1990 book, Artificial Experts, and Donald McKenzie's 2001 book, Mechanizing Proof, Computing Risk and Trust, are two such exceptions. But generally, however, when STS researchers have researched software, they've done so as ethnographers. Consequently, we learn a lot about the programmers and how they interact, but the texts of software are left out. So what was the code being written by the programmers? What were the technical papers being read by them? These questions are largely left untouched in what are otherwise very interesting works of STS, like Chris Kelty's Two Bits, The Cultural Significance of Free Software, and Biela Coleman's Coding Freedom, The Ethics and Aesthetics of Hacking. So in my book, I aim to complement existing STS work by studying the text of software. So software studies sits at the intersection of media studies and science and technology studies. Unlike some work in adjacent areas, software studies are critical of, but in close dialogue with, computer science. These characteristics are clear in what is frequently, if anachronistically, invoked as the first work of software studies. Phil Agree published Computation and Human Experience in 1997, and Phil's book is in conversation with STS and philosophy, but it is also, as he insists in the introduction, a work of computer science. So it would be unfair, I would say, to insist that works in software studies have to be, as Agree's was, seminal contributions to both computer science and to STS. But in my opinion, one of the distinguishing characteristics of software studies is that they read the text of computer science closely and against the grain. So I try to do so for my book, The Software Arts. First, I closely read some seminal work of computer science to uncover its ambiguities and contradictions. Second, I historicize it, that is to say, computer science, to find alternatives to current thinking that may have been lost over time. So my book is a study of computing as a technology of language and an understanding of software and software composition as a language art. The argument is that the foundational ideas and practices of computing come from the arts, specifically from a coupling of the liberal and the mechanical arts. The claim is that the software arts is a new name for something that has been ongoing for centuries, the pursuit of methods that provide us the means to invent and interrogate statements that can be or already are widely accepted as statements of connection, equivalence, or identity. And the stakes are threefold: pedagogical, industrial, and epistemological. So first, if software is an art, then education needs to change to integrate it into the arts. What do we teach? What do we learn? These are old questions that need to be posed again in a world where basic literacy is not a matter of Latin, Greek, or English, but of software. Second, if software can be written in the manner of an artist humanist, then new avenues of software production beyond engineering and science may be possible. And third, if software is the new lingua franca, then there are a series of ethical and moral questions that must be pursued in conjunction with this epistemological transformation. What counts as knowledge, for whom, and at what cost, to paraphrase Donna Haraway? The software arts are the fruit of a coupling of the liberal and the mechanical arts. To demonstrate this argument, the approach taken is partly historical, by tracing the genealogy of computing back to events before or during the initial professionalization of science and engineering, it becomes clear that computing, like science and engineering too, grew out of the arts. So prior to the so-called scientific revolution of the 17th century, there were no scientists, there were no professional organizations of science. Most studies that we would now identify as scientific were conducted under the name of natural philosophy, and natural philosophers most frequently published their works in Latin, in which the word scientia meant something broader than the modern cognate science, something more like the general term knowledge. The professionalization of engineering occurred even later. At that time and before, education and inquiry were carried out in the mechanical arts and in the liberal arts. The software arts is also a reading of the text of computing, code, algorithms, technical papers, that emphasizes continuities between prose and programs. Historically, it's possible to say that this position was first sketched out in the 17th century in proposals to develop artificial philosophical languages that were used to knit together the liberal arts, logic, grammar, rhetoric, the liberal arts of language, and the mechanical arts, for example, those practiced by artisans in workshops producing pins and stockings, locks, guns, and jewelry. When the writings of the mechanical arts were cookbooks, the descriptions were recipes, and when they were not cookbooks, they were how-to manuals with metaphorical recipes to explain step-by-step how things could be made. The language of the literal and metaphorical recipes, these artificial languages, became what we know today as computer programming languages. The claim is that contemporary artificial languages have shaped and been shaped by the arts and have rearticulated the relationship between the liberal and the mechanical arts, an assembly we currently call art, design, the humanities, and technology. Programming languages are the offspring of an effort to describe the mechanical arts in the languages of the liberal arts. Writing software is a practice of writing akin to the activity of novelists, playwrights, screenwriters, speechwriters, essayists, and academics in the arts and the humanities. And consequently, contemporary education, research industry, and technology development all need to change to better recognize how the arts sit at the center of computing. So while my position might strike some as radical, it's actually relatively well represented among some of the most influential experts in computing. For example, in an interview discussing the first Macintosh computer, co-founder Steve Jobs said, "Part of what made the Macintosh great was that the people working on it were musicians, poets, and artists, and zoologists, and historians, who also happened to be the best computer scientists in the world. And they brought with them, we all brought to this effort, a very liberal arts attitude." And this, he says this on many occasions. In my book, The Software Arts, I argue that Jobs was right. The arts and the humanities are at the heart of computing. Now, Jobs is not alone. There are many important computer scientists who have also put the arts and the humanities at the center of computing. Many programming language designers are frequently advocates of treating computing as a language art. Educator, designer of the Logo programming language, and artificial intelligence researcher Seymour Papert, in his book Mindstorms, wrote about how, at the time of Plato, there was no radical split between philosophy and mathematics, and how today we need to reintegrate the humanities and the sciences. So Papert's comments give one cause to recall that the traditional liberal arts, as studied and practiced in early modern era of Europe, included both the trivium, the arts of language, and the quadrivium, the arts of number. At that time, there was no strict boundary to be drawn between what today we call the arts, the humanities, and the sciences. And with the book, my aim is to help erase these boundaries. For each chapter of the book, I have a hope for the reader. So now I'm going to shift to the second part of my talk, where I'm just going to go through the book chapter by chapter. So to begin, if the first chapter, the introduction, has worked as I wished, the reader is willing to entertain the possibility that although computing can be seen as science, for example, computer science, and as engineering, for example, software engineering, it can also be seen as an art or a collection of arts, the software arts. Chapter 2 on translation is offered as a methods chapter. Translation is known to the scholar and to the computer scientist, but each is familiar with a very different flavor of it. The main example discussed in the chapter is a set of texts from the beginning of the theory of computation concerning Alan Turing's machines, Alonzo Church's lambda calculus, and popularizations of the Church-Turing thesis that claimed there are no limits to what a computer can do. And of course, this popularization is false. Turing's original publication shows definitively that computers do have limits. By reading popularizations of the text of software as a series of translations from the most technical to the most popular, I show how the popular reception of a technical text can result in a fantasy that contradicts the findings of the original publication. And my hope is that the reader will see how to reframe a popularization as a series of translations from the technical literature out into the wilds of popular culture, and also back in to the technical literature. The methodology presented is an amendment and an extension to actor network theory, also well known in STS as the sociology of translation. This contribution to actor network theory, or ANT for short, is the main methodological contribution of the book. In chapter 3, entitled Language, I argue that computers are not information technologies, and the operations of computing are not the functions of mathematics. To expand upon these assertions, I narrate the history of programming languages that starts in the artisans' workshops of 18th century France. I trace a history of the division of labor as it was comprised in these studios and workshops, and as it was transcribed by the economist Adam Smith in the first chapter of his book, The Wealth of Nations, as Gaspard Coigny revised Smith to organize large-scale calculations with human computers for post-revolutionary France, and as Charles Babbage devised a machine to embody Coigny's methods in his analytic engine. Ada Lovelace, who used the operations of the analytic engine to write the first computer program in 1843, called this a science of operations, and sharply contrasted it with mathematical logic. Lovelace wrote, "The science of operations is a science of itself and has its own abstract truth and value. Just as logic has its own peculiar truth and value independently of the subjects to which we may apply its reasonings and processes." So my hope is that through this history, the reader will come to understand the huge gap that separates logic and mathematics from computation, and the affinities shared between computation and the kind of work that is accomplished in the arts. Chapter 4 is on algorithms, and it's the chapter that I will elaborate on in just a few minutes, so I'll not summarize it here. It suffices to say that the chapter on algorithms launches one of the main narrative arcs of the book, the rise of arithmetic, or alternatively, the casting of everything as calculation. The focus of chapter 5 is the liberal art of logic. The computer as logic story is often told to emphasize the many contributions of the language art of logic to the development of the computer. I too retell that story, but include two details that are frequently included: materiality and history. It complicates the computer as logic story if one admits that computers of today, with power supplies, screens, and circuits, are materially very different than older works of logic printed on paper. And so, material details are usually sidelined in the telling of the computer as logic story. Historical specificity is also usually marginalized in the common narrative because logic, as it is articulated today in technical venues, is not very old. First-order predicate logic, for example, is an invention of the 20th century. Consequently, to narrate how logic begat computers becomes too complicated if one acknowledges that the logic of yesterday was a completely different animal than the logics of today. By examining a history of logic, the material specificity of logic circuits, and some of the softer design techniques of logic programming, my hope is that the reader will gain insights into how one can take a seemingly unitary, monolithic, technical topic like logic, and break it down into its many disparate parts. There's no such thing as logic with a capital L, only a multitude of logics all spelled with lowercase letters. The next chapter, chapter 6, is on the second art of the trivium, rhetoric. And Aristotle tells us that the strongest rhetoric is closely tied to logical demonstration. This chapter traces a history of rhetorical demonstration. The history of the demo starts in ancient Greece when definitive demonstration was a matter of deduction as practiced in geometry. Euclid's demonstration, or deductive demonstration, is displaced by inductive demonstration in the 17th century during the Scientific Revolution. Inductive demonstration, let's call it Robert Boyle's demonstration, was made necessary when arguments began to be based on empirical data and not just derived from statements taken to be obviously true. Today, arguments are made on the basis of so much data, so-called big data, that no one person could possibly read it all, much less observe its collection. This has necessitated the invention of yet another form of argumentation that I term abductive demonstration, or alternatively, Solomonov's and Kolmogorov's demonstration. The latest form of rhetorical demonstration is actually a kind of data compression that is otherwise known as machine learning. My point is concordant with media theorist Jonathan Stern's idea that we should now be concerned with compression rather than representation. One could say that the founding document of contemporary machine learning was Ray Solomonov's 1960 publication, A Preliminary Report on a General Theory of Inductive Inference. Employing a theorem in Solomonov's paper, Soviet mathematician Andrei Kolmogorov, who's pictured on the right there, articulated a theory of complexity. And the Kolmogorov measure of complexity of a collection of data is the length of the shortest computer program that can generate the data as output. So machine learning algorithms are designed to accept a collection of data and then search the space of computer programs to find the shortest one that is applicable. And we're meant to believe that big data sets are aptly characterized by the outputs produced by machine learning algorithms. But we have no way of checking the data. So I call this an abductive demonstration because Charles Peirce, who first articulated abduction in its contemporary sense, said that abduction is a form of guessing. Or we might say abduction is a form of interpretation, a practice well known to the arts and the humanities. The chapter proceeds from older means of making a point to the newest forms of persuasion. And I hope to provide the reader with ways to both question and compose software-based arguments. The final chapter is on the third of the three liberal arts of language, specifically grammar. For a long time, grammar was a political project prosecuted as pedagogy in order to homogenize written and spoken language of empires and then later deployed in an analogous manner to consolidate nation states. Grammar was predominantly prescriptive. Then, in the late 19th, early 20th century, grammar was reframed by linguists desiring to describe how language is actually used. With linguist and semiotician Ferdinand de Saussure, grammar became descriptive. And when it did, its locus moved from textbooks into machines, both mechanical and imagined mechanisms of the brain. By the mid-20th century, linguistics had joined forces with the mathematical formalism championed by David Hilbert, and this resulted in a transformation of linguistics to exclude meaning from its object of study. In the words of Noam Chomsky, quote, "The study of meaning and reference and of the use of language should be excluded from the field of linguistics." Instead, Chomsky and his followers pursue what they call linguistics in the form of meaningless syntactic manipulations, ultimately articulated as computer programs. So after Chomsky, grammar machines had become software, and claims were made that software could constitute a theory of language. And this represents a huge shift in intellectual culture. When a computer program, a piece of software, can be a theory, we have entered what I will call the computational episteme, citing Foucault. In a computational episteme, software is taken for theoretical insight and meaning is pushed to the margins. These conditions are strange and challenging, and I hope the reader will see that one way to make sense in a computational episteme, to remake meaning, is to act as an artist, to engage in the software arts. So now that you have a general outline of the whole book, I want to unfold a little bit of chapter 4 on algorithms. In their original form, algorithms were simply a new way to do arithmetic that arrived in Europe when merchant capitalism was a dominant force. With the rise of industrial capitalism, and now in the age of financial and linguistic capitalism, arithmetic went from being economically important to becoming the beating heart of the economy. So concomitant with this rise of arithmetic in commerce and industry was its transformation into a hegemonic form of knowledge from a circumscribed liberal art, where it was previously one of the quadrivium, the arts of number, that also included geometry, astronomy, and music. Originally spurred by the challenges of mathematics, over the course of the 20th century, mathematicians, linguists, logicians, and economists reduced huge swaths of intellectual terrain to arithmetic, to calculation, in a move called arithmetization. Arithmetization presaged what we now call digitization and convergence, and these moves to centralized calculation have been environmental disasters for many fields, as calamitous for thought as monocrop agriculture has been to the Earth's air, water, and soil. The hope for this chapter is that the reader, by following a history of the algorithm from early modern Venice to the computer algorithms of today, will be given the means to stop marveling at the power of algorithms and instead to begin to think beyond the current ideological limits of algorithms. To do this, one needs to understand the industrial and intellectual forces that have been applied for well over a century to translate the language arts into the liberal art of arithmetic, and once understood to reverse these translations. So the composition of the book is self-similar, with the same kind of arguments made for the book overall as they are made at the scale of the chapter. So I closely read a piece of computer science, looking for its instabilities, contradictions, and seeking clues to its historical precedents. I then chase down those historical precedents to see what's been lost or neglected that did exist that could serve as improvements or correctives to computer science of today. The instabilities and the contradictions are usually due to efforts to reduce everything to mathematics or logic, or more specifically to digitize, to turn it into a form of arithmetic, to collapse it into a concern of calculation. And in contrast, the historical alternatives I have found come from the arts and the humanities. So let's see how this plays out in the terrain of algorithms. Arguably, the meaning of algorithm did not really settle around the composition of software until the 1960s, when Donald Knuth started publishing The Art of Computer Programming, his multi-volume work on the analysis of algorithms. According to Knuth, there are five important features of algorithms. Finiteness. An algorithm must always terminate after a finite number of steps, a procedure which has all the characteristics of an algorithm, except that it possibly lacks finiteness, may be called a computational method. Definiteness. Each step of an algorithm must be precisely defined. The actions to be carried out must be rigorously and unambiguously specified for each case. Formally defined programming languages or computer languages are designed for specifying algorithms in which every statement has a very definite meaning. Input, quantities which are given to it initially before the algorithm begins. Output, quantities which have a specified relation to the inputs. And effectiveness, all of the operations performed in the algorithm must be sufficiently basic that they can in principle be done exactly and in finite length of time by a man using a pencil and paper. So note that Knuth's first feature, finiteness, implies that most of what we use computers for today can be called computational methods, but not algorithms. Operating systems, web servers, smartphone apps, Facebook, Google, in general, most systems are not algorithms, according to Knuth, because they are not designed to stop after a finite number of operations. Knuth's second feature of algorithms, what he terms definiteness has become orthodoxy in computer science, but it introduces a contradiction into the technical literature. On the one hand, Knuth's analysis of algorithms is supposed to be free of the contextual details of a given implementation. Yet, in his own description of definiteness, he tells us that it can be assured if the algorithm can be defined, that is, coded, in a programming language. And in his multi-volume work, Knuth uses a specific programming language of his own design, MIX, to define algorithms. In short, his articulation is tantamount to saying that algorithms are computer programs. However, elsewhere, Knuth explicitly states that algorithms are not computer programs, but rather something more abstract and completely independent of programming languages. Knuth's fifth criterion damns the definition of algorithm to the same slippery semiotic slope suffered by any and all non-technical language. Note first, Knuth defines algorithms as effective methods, but in the history of computing, there's a strong tradition of doing the logical converse, that is, of defining effective methods as those methods that have algorithms for their solution. We see this in, for example, Alonzo Church's writings. Knuth's statement therefore introduces a circularity. Algorithms are computational methods that are effective, and by a Church, effective methods are those that have algorithms. Finally, note that in his definition of effectiveness, Knuth states that, quote, the operations performed in the algorithm must be sufficiently basic that they can, in principle, be done by a man using pencil and paper. And the motivation for this is perfectly clear. Knuth means to exclude impossible steps from algorithms. That is, for example, first invent a perpetual motion machine, second, fly through the air like Superman. Such a list of steps, even if they're clear, are impossible and thus do not constitute the steps of an algorithm. However, really only by consulting the history of computing can we understand what Knuth means by operations done by a man using a pencil and paper. He does not mean a man like Rembrandt or Shakespeare. Rather, he means some typical man or woman. Specifically, he implicitly connotes the men and women who worked as computers for centuries before the invention of computing machinery, or even during. Some of you saw the film last year, Hidden Figures, right? The men, but usually women, who worked in teams to produce laborious arithmetical calculations. And these people who performed the job of computer were also a key reference for Alan Turing in his 1936 paper. By tying the definition of algorithm to what a man can do with a pencil and paper, Knuth and Turing put the technical literature of algorithms on a vague and imprecise foundation. Any well-trained humanities scholar would want more precision on this point. What Knuth meant by a man? Which man? Does he mean woman? Working under what conditions? In which historical period? With what kind of educational background? Knuth's definition of algorithm is self-contradictory insofar as he holds both that it is dependent upon coding in computer programming languages and is entirely independent of the same. His definition is circular insofar as algorithms are defined in terms of effective methods that are defined in terms of algorithms. It's highly restricted insofar as algorithms are supposed to be finite, i.e. to terminate after a finite number of steps. Yet most of what we use computers for today concerns systems that are designed to run endlessly and are therefore not algorithms, according to Knuth. Finally, Knuth's definition of algorithm smuggles in a highly circumscribed and yet ambiguous form of human subjectivity when he ties it to what an undefined man can do with a pencil and paper. So according to computer historian Michael Mahoney, there is a gap between the logic of the Turing machine and the circuits of a digital computer, and that computer science can be explained as an effort to fill that gap. Using Mahoney's description, we can diagnose Knuth's efforts as computer science, an attempt to make algorithms a kind of mathematics or logic, but a priori, algorithms are not mathematics, and so unsurprisingly, the analysis of algorithms is a very difficult discipline. Algorithms can be turned into mathematics with the same effort medieval alchemists turned lead into gold. So, if they're not mathematics or logic, then what are algorithms? Algorithms are part and parcel with what this historian of science, Pamela Long, describes as the history of writings from and about the mechanical arts, including, quote, ancient writings related to technical production, such as Hellenistic engineering books, as well as writings tied to political and military praxis, including Xenophon's Economicus and Roman agricultural writings. Tradition includes medieval guild regulation and continues on into today's language of patent law and how-to books, and crucially, this tradition of mechanical arts also includes recipes and cookbooks. So Knuth recognizes this direct connection to the arts. I mean, he does call his book The Art of Computer Programming, but he doesn't really pursue it with any rigor. So in chapter one of the first volume of The Art of Computer Programming, Knuth compares algorithms to recipes and asserts that a computer programmer can learn much by studying the recipe book, and then admits, quote, the author has barely resisted the temptation to name the present volume the programmer's cookbook. Perhaps someday he will attempt a book called Algorithms for the Kitchen. So Knuth is hardly alone in his comparison of algorithms to recipes. It continues to be idiomatic. Princeton computer science professor and the specialist in analysis of algorithms, Bernard Chazelle, wrote the following in his 2006 essay, The Algorithm Idiom of Modern Science. Algorithms are often compared to recipes. As cliches go, a little shopworn perhaps, but remember, no metaphor that appeals to one's stomach can be truly bad. Furthermore, the literary analogy is spot on. Algorithms are and should be understood as works of literature. So this tussle between mathematics and mechanical arts, between Knuth's ventured axioms of algorithms and cookbooks or of recipes, is emblematic of most every controversy I recount in the book manuscript. Frequently, as is the case here with the respective writings of Turing Award winner Don Knuth and the previous Collège de France professor Bernard Chazelle, the two sides of the controversy are authored by the same famous computer scientists. In a noetic register, they try to subsume software under mathematical logic. In a poetic register, they pull it back into the kitchen, the workshop, or the studio of the mechanical arts. But as can be heard in the quotes I've just cited, when a computer scientist calls computing an art, it is usually done in jest, or at least is done flippantly and without any rigor. My book manuscript asks, what would happen if we took these flippant quips seriously? What is software if it is indeed an art? So as historian Pamela Long's research into the writings of mechanical arts shows, one could pursue this question in a number of ways. Chapter 4 of my manuscript on algorithms is preceded by chapter 3 on language. And in that chapter, I pursue this question by starting with an examination of the craft recipes of 18th century France. And, excuse me, I contend in chapter 3 that the authors of the 18th century French encyclopedia midwifed the birth of a language to describe artisans' work and their machines. And over the course of the centuries, this became the ancestor of what we know today as programming languages. By printing as text and diagrams what the artisans spoke in the workshop, the encyclopedists paired the mechanical arts and the liberal arts. This coupling was a radical invention at a time and a place where the two had been kept separate for centuries. The French encyclopedists translated the everyday language of the workshop, a language of the mechanical arts, into a language of literature and learned discourse, the language of the liberal arts. Like all remarkable translators, the encyclopedists had to invent new language, specifically invented what I call a work language, to mean the language, the text, and talk employed to describe the processes and products of work. A machine language, also, a machine language is a work language employed in the design and analysis of machines. So when a machine is designed to replace a human in a work process, the actions performed by a human must be translated into a machine language. So a century after the publication of the Encyclopedia, Charles Babbage and Ada Lovelace were together able to precisely define work and machine languages in an endeavor Lovelace called a science of operations. And at the center of software is the work and machine languages of operations, birthed in the 18th century workshops of the French artists, designers, and artisans. The operations of computing are, even now, confused with the functions of mathematics. There's a huge gap between the artisan's operations of computing and the functions of mathematics. Many careers have been devoted to try to bridge that gap, to make computing a form of pure or applied mathematics, yet no perfect translation between the two has been found. Consequently, software remains an art and a craft quite unlike mathematics, and not at all a science written in functions, despite Lovelace's wishful phrase of a science of operations. So with this history of work languages, machine languages, and programming languages, it becomes possible to succinctly state the findings of the book. Algorithms are recipes, and any effort to formalize them as mathematics or logic is a very fraught endeavor. Logic is born as the twin of dialectic, the art of conversation, but when the twins are separated in late 19th and early 20th centuries, in the attempts to turn everything into arithmetic, logic loses its status as a form of reason and becomes just a kind of calculation. Rhetorical demonstration starts as an art of deduction, becomes a method of induction after the advent of the scientific revolution, and is now, in the age of big data, become what I call abductive demonstration. Abductive demonstration resembles artistic production more than the scientific method of inductive demonstration. In other words, data science is not a science, it's an art. In the 20th century, under the pressures of computerization, grammar collapsed into meaningless manipulations of syntactic forms that we first see in Chomsky and linguistics, and now know in the software systems like a Google Translate that have been forged from machine learning algorithms. So in all of these findings, my book, The Software Arts, charts the rise of the liberal art of arithmetic to its domination of the liberal arts of language, grammar, rhetoric, and logic. And my hope is that by telling the story of the rise of arithmetic, I can also provide a peek into how things could be otherwise, how we might act otherwise, pedagogically, industrially, epistemologically, if we could see software as a matter of the arts. Thank you.
The term physics envy comes to mind when you talk about the nature of kind of an apotheosis of arithmetic over, say, more. Emotional reasoning, so emotive reasoning. I mean, basically, I'm trying to remember the notion of what you said in terms of basically, if I can try and put it back into your words, how there became a dominance of a certain type of reasoning in the work and social and even academic sphere. So, and it seems like you have given that origin to a certain place of arithmetic, which seems, you know, so I'm wondering how arithmetic got from where it was to where you claim it got to. Let me try to put it as simply as that.
Well, so I think there's a bunch of ways of narrating that story. And I mean, the one thing to watch is just sort of the history of mathematics and logic in the 19th and the 20th century, right? So an example of
Hilbert, say.
Right, so Hilbert is kind of ties a lot of stuff together, right? But before that, we have someone like Peano trying to make the logical axioms of number, right? And then we get somebody like Boole, who's trying to turn the logic into arithmetic. Right? So it becomes a kind of circular project. Turn logic into arithmetic, arithmetic into logic. And this kind of chasing its tail, as Hilbert called it, the project of turning this back and forth between the two, really gets considerably boosted across many different disciplines when Hilbert gives his address, proposes all these problems that then, you know, people like Gödel, Turing, and so forth show to be, well, maybe not badly posed, but certainly not resolvable. So, you know, you get a bunch of other disciplines early in the 20th century, linguistics especially, that are really inspired by this whole notion of a Hilbert formalism, right? And you don't have all the mathematicians following this either, right? You've got intuitionism going at the same time. You've got these other people doing other things, but this little project became a big project.
If I can comment, because I think what you're saying is really important, and I just flashed on an analogy. So in the 19th and 20th century, the ideology of Darwinism showed up in incredibly destructive ways as nationalisms and colonialisms, and basically, you know, war separates, you know, the good from the bad. Now there's an ideology of arithmetic that I think you're pointing to make the analogy, ideology of Darwinism, ideology of arithmetic, that has given our culture in very interesting ways. And am I?
Yeah, I think that's what I'm trying to underline. And you can, you know, if you look at, if you just look at what's under the hood of something like deep learning, right, these neural networks or whatever, they're essentially polynomials, right? They're like n-dimensional planes to separate this thing from that thing. And when you write them out, you know, it's very simple, it's just a summation sign, or if you prefer a loop. Now they happen to have a billion parameters. You talk about something like Google Brain rewrote their translate service last year, and you know, they ended up with something that, if you read the technical papers, has several billion parameters to it. But still, it's just a simple sum when it comes right down to it, right? So you see it in the latest, greatest, like hyped stuff. Machine learning is going to save everything. What is it? It's pretty much arithmetic. And you see it through this whole period that I'm talking about, where meaning for linguistics, for a variety of other areas, was pushed aside so that things could become focused on arithmetic.
Hi.
Hi,
thank you for your talk. I have a question about the very easy question. Now I'm lying. Mm-hmm. No. You said at the end of your talk that you were thinking, hoping that we could envision how the pedagogical term, for example, would be once we envision software as an art. Practical example, how would we teach software as an art?
Well, I think I do already. I teach intro programming to my MFA students. So I think on a practical, in the classroom level, it's pretty straightforward, and what it rests on is picking the right examples. You don't have them compute the first 1,000 primes. Do that, it just melts the entire class. On a more practical basis, though, this quip I had at the end that data science is not a science, it's an art. What I was really trying to talk about is like a condition that we all know as artists, right? You don't know everything that's behind any given image that gets interpreted in an art context. There's a lot of things that go unknown. And this shift to the world of big data means that even if we could get the data, and we can't always do that. I mean, Google publishes a lot of papers where they say, well, we use this public data, but then we have like this many gigantic zillion pieces of data that we can't share with you, I'm sorry, right? Very, very odd from a scientific perspective. But we end up with a bunch of images. And we need to come up with forms of interpretation that I think are going to look a lot more like art history. Okay, look, if you remember your geometry from high school, like this little demonstration of how to build an equilateral triangle from Euclid is, you know, we can follow all that. Now things get a little more complicated when we get to Robert Boyle's air pump, but you know, we can do this. And if you read the original articles, like, you know, people are sitting in the room witnessing the gathering of the data and so forth. We can put ourselves there. What do we get? This is from the one of Google's papers on this translate. This is supposed to show, okay? Now, the people who were responsible for these images came in the thing are people that I know, Martin Wattenberg and Carrie Carlo. Fernando Villegas, who was at the Media Lab when I was there. You know, it's a group author paper, but we're supposed to see in this image here, if you read the paper, we're supposed to be able to see the creation of a universal language that melts all different languages together. Now look, I'm looking at this looks like a plate of spaghetti with a bunch of marbles in it here, right? So if we're going to take this seriously as an art, we have to say, that image does not show what you're saying it shows. And you can't use like the simple thing, you know, Robert Boyle, when he coined Boyle's law, you know, PV equals K. You get one equation, you get a little line, you know. We're totally out of that graphics. We're in this graphics. I think the only way to deal with this, especially since we can never look at the data, we can never witness the data, we've got to come up with forms of interpretation to understand this as an art. So, I think it goes far beyond just teaching intro programming. It comes down to how are we going to perform data science, if you will, as artists who take images seriously. Because that's not serious. That's ridiculous. And this is just full. Like, there's tons of stuff in journalism all over the place, right? Where these are the big data images. Plate of spaghetti with marbles thrown in. Doesn't show nothing. Yeah, go ahead, Dave.
I'm sure at first it's not convincing.
Oh, just a really quick naive question. I love the analogy of, you know, software as a cookbook. But I'm kind of disturbed by the idea that, for me, the work of art is the food, the dish that's presented, not the cookbook. I mean, the work of art is the piece of sculpture, not the sculpture class. So it's kind of this artisanal art as a way of making things definition. But if you take a more recent ideas of art, can you think of examples of code that's written specifically to be poetry?
To be what?
Poetry. Poetic code, not just.
I mean, there's a lot of there's a lot of code poetry, for sure. I mean, there's people that could do that specifically.
And do you address that in your book?
No, I don't. Hmm. Because what I'm pointing to here specifically is what, I mean, Pamela Long traces a very long history of, which is writings by people who are manual laborers, who are in the mechanical arts, making stuff, right? So there's this emergence. It especially blossoms, though, in the 18th century. And cookbooks is one place where it blossoms. Cookbook that I had up there, that old cookbook thing that I had, that was La Cuisinière Bourgeoise, which is this big bestseller in 1740. Tells you how to cook all kinds of stuff. This was a new thing, right? Where the cooks didn't just cook, they also wrote. So what I'm saying is that we can, when we look at what that writing style was, how is it that people invented the how-to book, if you will, we can find in that the roots of programming. Because programs say A, B, C, what to do, right? And so I think it's a good analogy. And I think it feels uncomfortable for reasons that are very old. That is to say, someone like Donald Knuth jokes about it, but isn't going to take this seriously because of some very old conditions where, you know, there was a strict division between certain kinds of education and certain kinds of intellectual production. So machines were over here, right, and philosophy and stuff is over there. So Bernard Stiegler talks about this in the beginning of his trilogy book. There's these Aristotelian barriers, let's just put them that way, where Aristotle separated stuff, and what we lived with it for so long in our educational institutions that, to give you an example, it's very hard to come to Berkeley and learn how to become a car mechanic. Why is that? Because, well, that's not considered a dignified form of knowledge, right? So what has to be done, what I'm doing here is just kind of, there's many other people like Bernard Stiegler who are talking about this. How do we break down those things? How do we actually take that knowledge and that style of writing from artists and artisans seriously and integrate it into our educational institutions and our intellectual endeavors right now?
So going back to sort of big news, our programming, the notion of the question is, who are the agents involved here? And there are maybe three. Two humans, the person writing the code, one non-human, the execution engine, the machine that runs it, and then and other human beings, the important parts, that interact with that operating program, that interact with the device, which is being, whose behavior, whose interaction is being determined by the program that was launched on it. So there are a number of purposes that are being served by the creation of this artifact. Kunitz also talked about the notion of literate programming, where there was another person, another group of people involved, maybe those who would read the program, not execute it, not experience it, not interact with it, but read it, perhaps understanding what it did, and practically as, say, open sources have shown, use it in some sense, pick it apart, cut it up, put a screwdriver to it, and use it. So there are these sort of potentially competing, but perhaps complementing points of view here. And some dangers involved, one being that those poor users may just think that Siri or Alexa has some notion that the Turing test has been passed. So I think the notion, I don't yet see the notion of the different interests of agents involved in software creation and use in this presentation.
So, you know, in this presentation, I was rather hard on Donald Knuth, but I should point out that that's just because of the brevity. One to reduce 400-page book to 40 minutes, you know, you can't be fair. Sorry. Knuth has this notion of literate programming, as you said, where we can imagine writing programs for other people, not even necessarily machines. This really kind of is a very different way of thinking about it. And it went along with his other project, which was in typography. Right? He said, we need to think about typography very seriously. And this is where you see an affinity between Steve Jobs and Knuth as well. Steve Jobs wanted good typography on the computer screen. This was non-trivial back when these two were thinking about it, right? So he's not guilty of necessarily this kind of patrolling the Aristotelian barrier, as I would put it, in all ways. But the problem is, he's the guy who really made algorithms the big topic that it is. I mean, many computer scientists will say that is the center of the thing. But if you look at, for example, Turing's 1936 paper, he says specifically that algorithms really have nothing to do with interactions. You're a third party of people, right? They have inputs, they have outputs, they don't interact though. He says specifically, we're going to deal with machines that you give it an input, it gives an output. It doesn't stop, it doesn't require anything. He does deal with that in his PhD dissertation with Alonzo Church in Princeton a few years later, but he doesn't deal with that. And it's that notion of algorithm, a thing that is really kind of it runs by itself, it does not interact, that's made it such that computer science is really hobbled for a vocabulary of interaction. Any kind of, there you can look at particular, even Turing Award winning works like Robin Milner's Pi Calculus is all about interaction, but it's about interaction between machines. If you want to talk about interaction between a machine and a person, because computer science has been so tied to algorithms, which by axiomatic definition are not supposed to deal with interaction, you always have to borrow from psychology, from sociology, from anthropology. This is a big area in all of the big concerns in Silicon Valley. You have a group of anthropologists, they have a bunch of people who are gonna do some kind of interaction design because it's always been excluded a priori. So all I'm saying is, okay, look, especially as more and more humanities and social scientists people get interested in trying to write about algorithms, I want to point out that if you read this stuff closely, you see that it's got all kinds of problems in its articulation, in Knuth's work. In Turing's original articulation, it cuts us off from all kinds of things. Knuth does it as well, right? I mean, if you take his definition of algorithm literally, that is to say, something that is finite, that stops after some certain number of steps. My point was that excludes most of what we deal with every day in computers. We deal with very few computations that start and stop and are done. They kind of go on and on. So we've got to mess with that. We've got to push that in some ways. And I would say, just by looking at those historical and sometimes artistic references that are sprinkled throughout Knuth's multi-volume work, The Art of Computer Programming, there's leads. We can pursue those things and say, okay, how does that supplement what's not in the math and the logic of the text?
I wonder how much this has to do with the difference between describing and defining. In ordinary discourse, you describe or you use an archetype in order to discuss. And this might be quite artificial. You might say, well, the average French family has 1.4 children. it'd be hard to find as an example, but it's a meaningful sort of abstraction. And in cooking, you might describe a cake, you might describe a pudding. My mother would experiment and decide which it was after she was done. You don't normally define a cake,
right,
or a pudding. And I was recently reading a book about Biennale historians who had such a big impact in France, and came across a scathing indictment of the tyranny of definition. The definition is a prison, and so on. And yet, it's the definition that is used in, is it a shift in emphasis from description to definition seems to be to characterize the 20th century and leads to a lot of the elaborate presentations.
No, I completely agree with you. I think that a lot of the book is taking definitions from computer science, things that are phrased as axioms, necessary and sufficient conditions for some particular thing, and giving them description. So historically, what is this? How do we unpack it? Where it comes from? Where do these axioms leak, so to speak? And I had a very enlightening fall at the Institute for Advanced Study in Paris, with an office right next to, you know, one of the greats in computational theory, Nachum Dershowitz. And Nachum writes two kinds of papers. One are papers of are axiomatic papers, right? So he has a so-called proof of the Church-Turing theorem. Now, that means that more or less anything that a Turing machine can do, a Turing machine can simulate any other kind of machine. Okay, so it's something that's never been proven, but Nachum claims with his and this is a relatively recent paper with his colleagues and students that he can prove it. But if you look at the way he proves it, it's all with a bunch of axioms, right? And as soon as you start saying, well, wait a minute, in what perfect world do these conditions actually exist? We just have a disagreement. I don't think it proves anything. He does another set of books, which are histories and descriptions. I guess this best-selling book in multiple editions now on the calendars, various kinds of calendar forms and things like that. And so Nachum manages to weave like the historical, the descriptive, with the definitive and the axiomatic. And I was just blown away by the whole thing, because you usually are dealing with someone who does definition but not description, or description and not definition. And I think the really productive thing is to try to weave the two together. And Nachum's the only person I know who can actually do it.
Well, a characteristic of functional and human things, that whereas a definition makes distinctions, in real life, there's usually a complete continuum, no great cutoff. There's a difference between an archipelago and an undulating planet.
Right. Yeah, so, you know, this notion that Knuth has, that, everything that's done by an algorithm should be able to be so simple that it could be done with a man with a paper and pencil. There's a reasonable interpretation of that, as I was trying to say. But there's a whole bunch of presuppositions that go into that, that if I choose to get a little more specific and ask, who is this man with his paper and pencil, and what's he doing, where is he, things like that, which are all perfectly legitimate questions in the arts and the humanities, collapse the axioms. They collapse them, because that doesn't hold water. It's a terrible description. It's not a description of anyone or anything or any place or whatever. So I think there is something to be gained by taking the axioms and undoing them with description.
Can I just jump in on that a little bit?
Yeah.
So to what degree is this a function of the historical paradox of the development of the digital computer itself, especially thinking about Turing, that the definitive and extremely simple, explicitly finite steps of an actual computer are in some ways not at all connected to the other realm of what we're talking about. But when humans are usually interacting around description interpretation, it's not through those, the medium of the formal steps. But when, as you mentioned, I mean, an algorithm is not telling another person what to do, or at least certain kinds of algorithms. And so, I don't know if this is clear, but one of my questions would be, most computer programs are not actually telling the computer what to do. They have to be compiled, and they have to be translated. And most computer programmers do not actually understand how those things are going to be translated into actual definitive instructions at the level of the chip design. The specifics about machine language. So I guess I thought I understood your argument, and maybe I'm just confusing myself, that is part of your argument that the discourse around the definitive has infected the layer that should be understood, in fact, as much more human? Or is this problem of this third inhuman agent always infecting it? I mean, it's clear to me that part of it, because at some point, a programmer is writing for another human user, but it has to be translated at some point down to something that even the programmer doesn't understand.
Well, so this gets a little bit back to what Mark mentioned but didn't put into his question about physics envy. Like, what are we trying to do when we're doing computer science, right? And Mike Mahoney, this historian of computing, one of the first people to really start writing about the history of software, has great work on kind of early theoretical computer science. And he talks about the struggles that von Neumann goes through, for example. Taking this machine, right, it's really an unruly machine when you talk about ENIAC, right, and trying to come up with a logical description of it, and saying, look, there's this huge distance between the machine and the descriptive mathematical logical formalism that I want. And he complains explicitly in his notes that this is so far from the kind of mathematics that he knows that he doesn't know how he's going to get from his mathematics, his sort of mastery of mathematics and logic, to an apt description of the computer. But that is, and this is Mahoney's trope of the gap, there's this huge gap between what the machine actually does and how people want to describe it, right? And so there's an aesthetic for people who followed von Neumann, who followed Turing and so forth, that it should look mathematical. And I'm saying, well, why not have it look more like recipe books than mathematical? But, you know, it's the gap is always really there, especially if you're in this business for long enough. I started writing Java when it came out. Java 1.0 in 1994, I've got some good code from then. You think it runs in Java 8 today? Not at all, right? The Java virtual machine is not at all. And this, despite the fact that Sun advertised the language as write once, run anywhere. They just didn't say any time. They're going to change the language, right? So it's just on a pragmatic level as somebody who writes software. Like, you know all that stuff that you try to say, okay, right now it's all set. It's going to change. You just don't know exactly when. And it's all, like, building on quicksand.
Well, the first Java was Java A and then Java B, and that was before Java 1.
Okay, I started with the first Java.
So I actually, when I saw your title and abstract, I expected to hear a lot more about this particular issue, which I think is a consequence of this big gap. There's many ways of expressing algorithms, and there's been a lot of experimentation in programming languages, and the range of possibilities is enormous. I mean, the style in Prolog, for example, or the style in APL are hugely different, and, you know, enormously different from Java and from Python and many of the widely used scripts today. These differences show up in, you know, ways of dealing with concurrency, perhaps more richly. And in the culture of computer science, these choices of languages, which actually, I think, shape thought about algorithms, also lead to cultural splits. I mean, you get religious dogma among, I mean, computer science, some computer scientists are the most dogmatic people I know that, you know, have a faith centered around a language and a way of thinking about algorithms. And it's quite different from these other ways. And there's this whole cultural dynamic in, you know, the development of languages over time. That, to me, is a tremendously interesting humanist study. So I expected to hear more about that here, and I didn't really hear any of it.
Well, that comes up in my teaching, especially when I teach artists how to program. I try to tell them there are many kinds of programming languages, and each has a community behind it that is trying to solve certain kinds of problems. And that you need to figure out for any given project whether or not you're in harmony with that community. But it's very much a social production. I mean, it's something all of us who've been programming for a while have lived with. You know, my first computer science teacher was Alan Perlis, and so he taught us APL, and you know, that was a crazy mind twister because I learned Fortran before that. And I spent a bunch of my youth in American artificial intelligence labs where everything had to be phrased in Lisp, and then I moved to Europe for a while, and suddenly I could do Prolog. But you couldn't do Prolog in an American AI lab without getting clobbered over the head repeatedly by people, because there's this kind of quasi-religious war that goes on. So these things become, as a software designer, very lived experiences, and they're not just abstract communities, they're real people with real problems that are trying to solve this stuff. I started with an idea of a book, something like that, and I do a little bit of it. I actually show some Prolog, and I build a circuit simulator and show some of that and things like that. But really, my motivation for writing the book was to connect first with my students, who are mostly art students and humanities students, and also with my colleagues who are in the arts and the humanities. And so this chapter, for example, on algorithms, I'm frankly very worried with how many of my colleagues in the social sciences and humanities are interested in algorithms, but they seem to have never read sort of the basic text of the whole thing. So that's, you know, there's the book, I've been working on it for 6 years, right? So the book has gone a variety of different ways, but I'm completely convinced that this issue that you're bringing up is extremely important. It just didn't happen in this version of the book.
Yeah, thank you. So would it be fair to say that at the very fundamental part of this conversation is whether we can differentiate and define science versus art at all, and do we want to, versus we want it to be a continuum, and it's a unproductive, if you will, dichotomy. And how would you define science and art?
So again, I have to go back to my motivations for the book, right? So there's two things that are motivating me. One is I am in the arts division at UC Santa Cruz, and I think that despite the fact that I have many colleagues in the sciences and the engineering that I work with, that I have good dialogue with and so forth, there is a kind of denigrated status of the arts and humanities. Okay? And so what I'm really, part of this is simply to say, everybody deserves respect. Look, I'm gonna make this argument, it's gonna be a pretty hardcore argument to say, computer science is not a science, it's an art. Therefore, we own it, right? But it's a counter to like what's been repeatedly dismissed, right? Repeatedly dismissed. You look at the proceedings of the first conference on software engineering in 1968. There are these disparaging comments about, you know, till now, software has been an art, we need to make it engineering. As though that was a bad condition to be in. And I want to say, no, it's not a bad condition to be in. It's perfectly fine for it to be art. We're extremely rigorous too, as artists. The other thing that's motivating this is that I teach a bunch of this stuff to undergraduates and grad students who are coming from the arts. And they, when they look at, you know, computer programs are an example of it, but all kinds of stuff that has to do with the technical goofy stuff in the middle of digital media, they don't want to know about it. They're like, no, that has nothing to do with me. I don't need to know about that at all. And my motivation for telling this story is to say, no, you're at the middle of the story already. Just relax, right? So it's a teaching thing, and it's also a respect thing. And so I'm really more interested in what I mentioned at the beginning there with Seymour Papert's comments, like, let's try to blur these boundaries between the two. Let's not set up these dichotomies. But there's some rhetorical excess in the book that is like jabbing back.
Okay, we should have a couple more questions then here.
Can you put your 7 dissenses up?
Oh, sure. Okay.
I didn't see who was first, so we'll just go.
So I'm really interested in your argument in the context of some history of computing work, like from Margix and Nathan Ensminger, who talk about how the definition of computing as an art or a science was used to either bring certain people into the profession or keep it out. So I guess my question for you is, how do you sort of incorporate that into your argument at all? Is that just not the part of it?
No, that's really in the introduction, because I'm trying to unroll some of my motivations in the introduction. And Ensminger's work on really how systematic discrimination against women was implemented through standardized mathematical tests, which they turned out had absolutely no correlation. Being good at math turned out to be completely uncorrelated to being a good programmer, right? And I think, you know, it becomes really clear that's a move of discrimination. It's not so innocent as I've made it out today, right? That people are following von Neumann or they want it to be math or something like that. Some people want it to be math and they want to get rid of the women. And that was really, Ensminger's work makes it really clear that that's what it was about.
Right, and he also argues that in order to get men into the profession, that they also framed it as a creative thing because of the way that computation had been feminized with like the pictures of the ladies, right?
Yes.
So that basically the way that it was shaped, the way that it was framed was used to exclude women.
Right. So, I mean, unfortunately, and Ensminger makes this point, is, you know, at first, almost everybody who was a programmer was a woman, and it's just gone down and down and down, and it continues. I graduated with an undergraduate degree in computer science in 1985, when it was almost half women who graduated nationwide, and now it's way down from there. I don't know, the latest figures I had was something like 2014 or something like that, where it's 20% or something like that. I mean, it's just like this. See people trying to undo this. So Apple had a big diversity campaign a couple summers ago, where they were really trying to say, you know, they were doing this Steve Jobs thing. They were saying, this is really about liberal arts, this is really about all these other things, trying to be much more inclusive. It's just, you know, a unfortunate formation, computer science education today. It needs to be undone. And so part of this is a call for that. It's really, okay, how do we, let's don't think of it that way, because these are not just innocent. At least not for everybody.
hear a last question.
At first I was thinking this was unrelated, and now I'm seeing maybe some other relationships, but it was actually related to something that's earlier, and sorry to go back to the dichotomy. I guess where I'm seeing the relationship to art, I'm also seeing a relationship to craft.
Yeah.
And what I, the way that you're framing the art is the way that I think about the way craft is framed in contemporary art.
Yes.
And so I'm wondering if there is maybe more of a relationship to the history of craft than to the history of what I think of as contemporary art today.
Yeah, so this is, so I teach contemporary art as well. I teach theory of contemporary art for my MFA students, PhD students. I am an artist. I show in museums and galleries and things like that. And I oftentimes get this question from people who are part of the contemporary arts world. And what I'm trying to do in the book, this was again something that I had in there and then I took out. You know, this notion of art really goes back a long ways, and really just mean, you know, how to do stuff. And so it was applied across crafts and arts and things like this. This notion of what is art today in the contemporary art context is a totally recent invention. It's pretty much, I don't know, you could maybe give it a century, but I don't think so. And so what I do is I rewind back to before that distinction was being made, and just go with that, right? And this is a lot of people are gonna say, but that's not what's in the museum and stuff like that. But to kind of break that down, I need to also break down what is a very unfortunate contemporary division between art and craft in the contemporary art world, right? So I'm just subsuming all that stuff etymologically.
All right, thanks so much. That was a long